Welcome back everyone to the lecture about applied parameter analysis. So in this part I will show you how to process tables with Python. As you may have realized earlier during the image to macro part, but also during the secret image part, we basically do image analysis to derive a table of measurements from our images, and then we continue processing these tables. And it's not so convenient, I mean really like not done in ImageJ, it's more something people do in Python, and that's why I would like to show you a bit in very general how this works. So the typical use case is you get a data from a colleague, or you analyze it yourself, some images in ImageJ, and you save this table to disk, and the question is now how to open and analyze tabular data in Python. NumPy is one of the potential answers for that, the one I introduced you first to, because you are already used to NumPy now, and it has a function called loadTxt. So you can enter here a CSV file, so this is the files we saved during the past weeks in ImageJ, and you have to specify a delimiter, especially, so you have to specify the delimiter comma. Some of you may have experienced the issue that you cannot open these files in Excel, then all the numbers are squeezed in one single cell. That has something to do that Excel, depending on the language settings, actually misunderstands the file. So it does not take the comma as a separator between different numbers, between different cells. In order to prevent that the loadTxt function of NumPy has the same misunderstanding, we have to specify it here. We have to specify that the comma is the separator in our comma separated values file, CSV. Furthermore, these tables usually contain a headline and then some numbers, so we want to skip the first row because there are strings and we only want to analyze the numbers in the table. So if you leave the skip rows here out, you may get an error message. So you may wonder, how do I know this? I know it from the website. Yeah, so when you go to numpy.org and you Google for how to open a text file, how to open a CSV file with Python or with NumPy, you will end up on this website which explains you or which shows you that there's a loadTxt function and that it has a file name as parameter. And furthermore, if you scroll further down this website, it also explains you the delimiter and the skip rows parameter. This is something nobody has that, maybe nobody has that in mind. This is things we read on the website, on the documentation of NumPy, in case we struggle with these things. So you could just start with calling loadTxt filename, then you may get an error message. You think about, okay, how do I skip the first row, and then you change your code until, according to the website, you change your code until you have this data set loaded and until your table, when printing this table out, looks like this in your Jupyter notebook. Then you can go through all the rows in a table with a for loop, and it is as intuitive as that. So you say for row in table, print out row. And I'm printing here another additional empty line so that we can actually see the differences between them. So you can go through a table row by row. You can also access individual cells in tables. For example, if you want to get the aspect ratio, you take in the row, it's the fourth column. So this is basically what you get from the table as it was saved on disk or as you saw in an ImageJ. This is one way of accessing individual cells in these tables. And last but not least, if you, for example, analyze images and you end up with a table in Python and you want to save this table to disk, you can save this table by using the saveTxt method, which also takes a file name, which also takes a table. Then you have to enter the header, which is a bit inconvenient, but it is what it is. And furthermore, the delimiter, which should be put between the numbers. And if you do it like I did here, then you get a proper table out, which you can then afterwards open, for example, in Excel. There is a potential alternative to that. So I just showed you how to process images with only NumPy, and there is people who do it like that. There's also more convenient libraries for processing tables. And it's at the end, it's a matter of taste. So I would like to also show you Pandas, because Pandas is quite popular when it comes to working with tables and to rearrange and filter and working with columns and rows. Pandas is a very popular tool for this. So So conda install pandas is the command you have to execute in order to use it. And then the use case is actually the same. Yeah. So we want to open a table. And this is in this case, we say pandas.readCSV and also they expect from us a delimiter. So I say here pandas, even though it's just PD, so it's similar to what we learned last week with NumPy. For some developers, pandas was too long to type. That's why they have the shortcut here. So if we import pandas as PD, and then we can from PD call pandas functions, like for example readCSV. And you see here when you then put this data frame, which is the result of this thing, when you put it on an empty line in a Jupyter notebook, it is printed out, it is shown to you, and you see already that this table is much easier to read compared to the tables we saw before, which are visualized as dictionaries or as arrays. Maybe you want to go this way in order to have a nice visualization of the tables, a convenient working with tables in Jupyter notebooks. Furthermore, you can with pandas access columns, which is quite practical when it comes to, for example, analyzing the mean of measurements given a certain measurement type. So for example, if you write data frame mean, so this is basically a dictionary, obviously, right? You get these numbers here back visualized as the column of the table. And with NumPy, you could, for example, measure the mean of the means in this case. And furthermore, you can also access individual elements like that. This is basically what I showed you earlier. You are accessing here an array element in a dictionary. So this is how pandas allows you to deal with data. Furthermore, you can also create tables with pandas. So for example, you did some measurements and you now want to create a table from that and analyze this table further. Creating a table looks like that. You define, first of all, a header, which is an array of headers of this table, ABC. And then you have your data. And what is a bit inconvenient at the very beginning, but you get used to that quite soon, is that what we write here as rows will be later in the table columns. That's why I wrote it here as a comment. And so the first line I write here is our column A. So you see that, you will see that soon, the tables here are rotated by 90 degrees. So you see here A, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the first column. This is the first column. And in order to visualize it a bit more conveniently, you can also transpose this table. So basically, with this data frame function here, you create a new table, you hand over the data and the header, and then afterwards you call transpose to get a table out as we are used to it. Yeah. And then you can, for example, save it to disk as CSV. So this may be in the exercise, may be important for you if you analyze some images. That's one of the exercises today. You analyze some images, you save the analysis results in a table, and then you save this table to disk. And then when you have the table saved, you make another Jupyter notebook, for example, for analyzing that table. So this is, a rather convenient workflow for splitting these two things, but still using the same technology. And also these things I just showed you on slides are saved in a Jupyter notebook. So you can go to the Jupyter notebook folder, processing tables with pandas, for example, and you can then reproduce what I did here. So I load some data from disk, then I visualize it, and I'm just looking at a particular column. And if you, for example, think, okay, let's take a look in another column. So this here is aspect ratio. And let's look in the column roundness. Yeah, shift enter, execute it, and then you get these different numbers out which correspond to the values over here. So you can modify this code, play a bit with it, try to understand what it's doing, and also later in the exercise you can copy paste from here and try to make it work on your particular use case. This is why Jupyter notebooks are so practical for communicating, also for teaching. Let's come to the exercises. The exercises today is, so I kept the lecture a bit short, to give you more time for the actual exercises. The exercise will be the following. And create a new Jupyter notebook. You are free to copy from other Jupyter notebooks, but please make one notebook for yourself and open an image, in this case a banana slice, so you can download this image and open this image, apply different filters to it and show the results. So really like have different filters next to each other in code blocks, for example, and try to also use different sigma values for the Gaussian blur to get a bit of feeling of how to do this. And then apply the O2 threshold to the unfiltered image, to the original one, and measure the area. And then you open ImageJ, you load the same image, you apply the O2 threshold to this image, and you measure the area, and you compare these two techniques. So just with a single image. When you manage that, if you can do it in ImageJ, and if you can do it in Python, then go ahead to the next exercise. You download the whole banana dataset, which is, I'm not sure how many, 20 images of banana slices taken with an MRI. And please write a workflow for opening the images, all the images in that folder, threshold them using the O2 algorithm, no pre-processing, no post-processing, only the O2 thresholding, and measure the area of the banana slice, and then save the area for every slice in a CSV file on disk. You are free to do this with ImageJ Macro. You can also do it with CLIJ in ImageJ Macro or in Python using scikit-image and NumPy. And if you are super motivated, you can do it in all three technologies. But for now, I would say one of these three is enough. It's your free choice which programming language you use for that. By the end of the semester, I would hope that you can do exercises like that in any programming language, ImageJ Macro or Python, as you wish. Furthermore, you find the solutions in the exercise folder in order to compare your solution to a kind of default solution. And furthermore, it helps you for the next exercise. Because the next exercise is, please create a Jupyter notebook, load the tables with the results from ImageJ and Python, ideally your results from at least one of these techniques, but both tables are there in the folder. So you can do this exercise first if you like. And determine the means of these both measurements, so the O2 algorithm applied to a folder of images in Python and versus ImageJ. Draw histograms of these measurements, draw a scatter plot of these measurements, draw a Blunt-Altmann plot of these measurements, and determine the confidence interval between these measurements. So you will see that the Blunt-Altmann plot, if you have the same result as I do, you will see that the Blunt-Altmann plot has actually a quite interesting curve here. So if I would be an algorithm developer, I would now dig deeper, but I'm just a method comparison person, that's why. We can then, for example, discuss in the Zoom meeting what we can read from this shape in the Blunt-Altmann plot, but therefore I would hope that all of you can draw the Blunt-Altmann plot of this data yourself and also determine the confidence interval and have a look at these histograms and try to understand a bit what happens here to the data and what are we looking at. Furthermore, sometimes it is helpful if you watch videos or if you read tutorials from other people. So if I am just explaining Python in a way which is not exactly the way you like it most or you understand it best, I would like to give you some additional resources online. So there is from the Software Carpentries, there's a very nice Python course where you learn how to process data in tables, numbers, from scratch. So you can also have a look at this one. Furthermore, there is an image analysis course from the British Microscopy Society, which you can also have a look at. And there is a nice YouTube webinar of the New Bias Society about interactive bioimage analysis and Jupyter Notebooks. So it's all similar to stuff you have seen earlier, but maybe sometimes just a different view, a different way of explaining it makes things clearer. And that's why I wanted to provide these links here to these resources. This week we did method comparison in quite detail. We had a look at comparison of means, at Pearson's correlation coefficient, scatter plots, Blunt-Altmann plots, the confidence interval and the coefficient of repeatability to quantify, to get a bit of feeling of how different methods deal with data. Furthermore, we had quite some look into how to do all these things in Python. Next week, we will start with inferential statistics and we will start having drawing conclusions from the measurements we did so far. We will have a look at the central limit theorem and hypothesis testing. And I'm not sure yet what I will show you new in Python. That will also depend a bit on how the exercises are going. So feel free to provide feedback, then I can tune a bit the speed of how we go through the Python environment. So that's it for this week. See you next week.